Good afternoon and welcome back to this series of webinar. Today we are focusing on the use of the equivalent frame approach in the presence of an irregular opening distribution. We will see different sources of irregularity that may affect existing masonry buildings, which can simply consist of the presence of a window and a door, or can be the effect of renovation work made in the time. The problem of the application of the equivalent frame approach to buildings with irregular geometry was analyzed by researchers in the last years to help practitioners on the application of this method in this context when the building has an irregular opening distribution. In this webinar, we will also discuss some criteria that can be applied to achieve a reliable response, even in the presence of an irregular opening layout. In a masonry building, walls are the main structural elements and they are vertical subsystems made of piers, which are the portion with the vertical axis, and spandrels, which are the regions with the horizontal axis, is here in pink. Walls carry loads and also transfer horizontal actions to the foundation. These vertical subsystems are connected by floors that also redistribute horizontal actions between walls. According to the equivalent frame approach, it is possible to identify the formable portion and portions that are not affected by damage, so rigid nodes. And assembling these elements, it is possible to build an equivalent frame model. In a regular wall, it is easy to identify the geometry of the elements of the equivalent frame, but the process can be challenging in the presence of an irregular layout. Spandrels are the horizontal elements, and we can say they are horizontal masonry beams and they can couple piers that are the vertical elements, the masonry column of our frame. The distribution of horizontal action to the vertical elements and the capacity of the system depend on the coupling effect provided by spandrels that influence also the vertical stress variation as a consequence of the application of horizontal forces. We can say that we have a frame behavior thanks to the spandrel's capability to transfer horizontal actions. Without these elements, the structure has a cantilever behavior. To analyze a structure using the equivalent frame model, we assume that local mechanisms are prevented. So the activation of local mechanism has to be associated to a greater ground acceleration with respect to the one that cause global mechanism. If the structure is more vulnerable to local mechanism, we have to design a retrofit intervention to avoid it. Regarding the global response, some codes refer to two main conditions that represents the two limit conditions, and their occurrence depend on the relative strength of spandrel and piers. The first condition assume strong spandrels and weak piers, and it can be representative of new buildings with rigid diaphragms. This hypothesis assumes that piers crack first, assuming infinitely rigid spandrels and perfect coupling between piers, which are in a fixed-fixed condition with any rotation allowed. The opposite hypothesis, the opposite condition requires uncoupled piers in a cantilever condition, so weak spandrels and strong piers. In this case, the assumption is that spandrel crack first and represent a more realistic choice when flexible floors provide at the most coupled horizontal displacement of the vertical elements. In most cases, damage is located at both spandrel and piers, and we can say that the global response is between these two limits conditions. This observation is confirmed also by numerical analysis. In this case, we present the results obtained with affinity element model, where damage is located at both spandrel and pier elements, even in the presence of an irregular opening layout. This result also suggests that it's possible to adopt the equivalent frame approach even to analyze an irregular structure. Indeed, the equivalent frame strategy idealizes masonry structure into a frame of deformable regions and rigid nodes. This layout is derived from experimental and post-earthquake observation, indicating that damage is located in recurrent areas, so in spandrels and piers, where others work as rigid parts. In the equivalent frame model, spandrels are identified as the element between two aligned vertical openings, and piers, which are the main elements carrying vertical load and providing resistance toward horizontal actions, are defined according to a discretization criterion. Rigid nodes are the portions delimited by these deformable elements. Spandrels, as we said in the previous slides, allow to couple the lateral response of peer elements, also influencing their boundary conditions, restraining their end rotation and thus affecting the lateral capacity of masonry panels. Spandrels and piers are defined as structural elements, and then strength criteria are assigned to associate an in-plane mechanism, maximum displacement, and the element strength to that element. The strength criteria account for the geometry, the boundary condition, the material properties, and the level of compression on elements. This topic was discussed in the third webinar of this series. Using the strength criteria, we are able to describe the macroscopic behavior of spandrel and pier elements. In the discretization process, spandrels and piers are identified and assembled in a frame that can represent the behavior, the lateral response of the real wall, with the automatic identification of the most probable failure mechanism. Rigid nodes are delimited by deformable elements, so by spandrels and piers, and they carry their own mass, and they are restrained to the frame nodes. This procedure, the identification of elements and the construction of the equivalent frame, is the one adopted by the software Tremuri. Let's see some examples of discretization into an equivalent frame. The first example is a regular building. And in this case, is it easy to identify the geometry of portions to be idealized and as spandrels and piers, thanks to the presence of openings vertically and horizontally aligned? Also in this case, we have a fairly regular geometry and we can easily identify a frame of deformable and rigid portions. In this case, we have some irregularities. The first is represented by the presence of a porch, and the second by the presence of two windows closed with infills. Assuming poor connections between infills and the adjacent masonry and a weaker material in that regions, we can neglect that portions that can be idealized as openings. For the second irregularity, due to the presence of this arch, the rigid nodes have an irregular geometry that cannot be obtained with an automatic mesh but needs to be modified manually. In this case, we have a wall with again different irregularities. At the ground level, we have a door and a window, and this requires an intermediate height for the central pier. With the top end aligned with the two openings. However, in this case, if the portion below the window has a lower thickness, we can also neglect that part modeling a door. The spandrel also has an horizontal offset due to the misalignment between the door and the window at the first level. Finally, the absence of the opening at the first level forces to create a single pier with an intermediate height between the window and the interstory height. The equivalent frame obtained has rigid nodes with very irregular geometry. Equivalent frame model take into account for the variation in axial force due to alternating sine horizontal actions. So it updates step by step the element strength on the basis of the axial force variation. In this case, when the horizontal action are applied from left to right, this wall is governed by a shear mechanism. When the horizontal action have the opposite sign due to a lower axial force, the same wall, the same pier, will experience a flexural behavior. If it is possible to update the element strength step by step on the basis of the variation of the axial force, on the other hand, the geometry of the equivalent frame is defined and cannot be changed during the analysis. This can be an issue, as in a real building, the external piers may be governed by flexural or shear mechanism, depending on the axial force and thus on the direction of the horizontal actions. This leads to different crack patterns and different effective height of these piers. Internal spears usually have a higher axial load and they are more often governed by shear mechanisms. Analyzing the crack pattern presented by a wall after an earthquake, we can see how the crack direction can be explained considering the two directions of horizontal forces. In this case, external piers are governed by flexural mechanism, whereas the internal piers are governed by shear or flexural mechanisms. The crack develop from left to right, starting from the opening corners. Analyzing the other case with horizontal forces applied in the opposite direction, we can explain cracks developing from right to left, starting from the opening corners. In this case, even if we may need two different models with the effective height changing with the direction of the horizontal forces, we prefer to build a single model. This choice is done due to the possible developing of torsional response that make impossible to predict the direction of cracks and thus the effective height of piers. The discretization criterion adopted to build the equivalent frame model to choose the effective height of piers has to take into account for this issue to be reliable for any direction of application of the horizontal forces. The most famous discretization criterion was developed by Dolce for a story mechanism approach. And it was based on finite element models analysis on pier spandrels subsystems, accounting for the pier stiffness and elastic rotational and translational restraints provided by spandrels. This criterion assumed the equivalent effective height of the pier equal to the distance of midpoints of the line connecting two consecutive opening corners, further incremented by a contribution proportional to the difference between such distance and the interstory height. A limit of 30 degrees was assumed for the inclination of the line connecting consecutive opening corners, and the criterion was calibrated by Dolce comparing the statistical evaluation of the equivalent stiffness obtained with the finite element model and the elastic stiffness of a pier calculated considering the classical relation for a Timoshenko beam. Another criterion was proposed by Moon, based on the result of a full-scale test. The method defined the effective height as the height over which a compression strut is likely to develop. And according to this criterion, the compressive strut is defined assuming that cracks can propagate at 45 degrees or horizontally, offering the minimum lateral resistance with the steepest possible angle. A similar criterion was formulated also by Augenti, and it was based on the post-earthquake observation. According to the criterion proposed by Augenti, the effective height of a pier should be the height of the opening following the pier in the direction of the seismic load. This criteria leads to different discretization depending on the direction of the applied load in the presence of an irregular opening distribution. Nonetheless, the use of the equivalent frame approach for dynamic analysis requires an unique model. To understand the influence of different discretization criteria on the lateral response of equivalent frame models, I'll show some results of a recent work. To understand the effect of several irregularity on the equivalent frame reliability, we selected 13 irregular configurations developed from a regular facade, which was tested by Professor Magenes at the University of Pavia in 1995. So we know the experimental response of the first configuration. Three equivalent frame models of each irregular configuration were built according to three discretization criteria. The first criterion assumes pier's effective height as the masonry wall's minimum clear height between two consecutive openings. The second approach is derived from Dolce discretization criterion, and it assumes the effective height as the distance between the midpoints of the segments connecting two opening corners with a limit of 30 degrees for the inclination of that line. The third criterion is equal to the second one without any limitation on the maximum inclination of the corner connecting line. This last is the one implemented in the commercial software Tremuri, and it is the criterion proposed by Professor Lagomarsino. The macro element adopted in this work is the macro element developed by Professor Penna and implemented in the research version of Tremuri program. This macro element is able to reproduce the flexural and shear behavior also in a cyclic test. The results obtained with the equivalent frame models were compared with the benchmark provided by a discrete model calibrated against experimental test. The micromodeling approach adopted in this study is based on the apply element method, which can be classified as a rigid body and spring model, and it is a simplified micromodeling approach as units are modeled separately and they are expanded in both directions to account for the joint thickness. Mortar joints are modeled as zero thickness interfaces where the nonlinear response is lambda. Units can be further divided to account for the brick failure. The equivalent frame model and the apply element method based model were calibrated through the simulation of two in-plane shear compression tests on a slender and a squat wall, tested at the Joint Research Center of ISPRA in Italy under double fixed boundary conditions. The results show that both the equivalent frame and the apply element method based model reproduced the failure mechanism, damage pattern, and the experimental hysteretic loops. Then the models were further refined through the simulation of monotonic static analysis on both directions using the three equivalent frame models, which are built adopting the three discretization criteria, so the minimum, the average, and the limited effective height. The monotonic curves were compared with the experimental backbone curve of one of the two facades obtained by the cyclic test performed by Professor Magenes at the University of Pavia. The considered facade named or wall, which was the one representing our regular configuration, was disconnected to the transversal walls in the specimen and thus considered independently in this work. The horizontal forces were applied through a system of trusses connected to the actuators placed at the floor levels, which allow to keep constant ratio between the applied force. The same system of trusses was built in the apply element method based model, whereas Tremuri software allowed to perform pushover analysis with forces uniformly distributed along the height. Also in this case, we had a good agreement between numerical results and experimental outcomes in terms of pushover curves and damage pattern. Then the numerical models were used to perform monotonic static analysis to evaluate the lateral response of the regular configurations. The comparison was done in terms of maximum base shear and initial lateral stiffness, comparing the values obtained with the three equivalent frame models and the apply element-based model. From this slide, we can see how starting from close values in the regular configuration, the differences increase with the regularity and the direction of the horizontal forces. In the negative direction, we obtain lower differences as the regularity consists in the opening in the right side. The greater differences between the three criteria were identified when the regularity consists of an opening with a reduced size. Indeed, when a small opening is present, the equivalent frame approach tends to assume a non-deformable zone even in regions affected by cracks, according to the apply element method-based analysis. This leads to a stiffer response and a higher base shear resistance predicted by the equivalent frame, especially when the criterion of the minimum effective height is considered, so the red one in this slide. The most interesting configurations were analyzed with the apply element method-based model to assess the reliability of the three criteria adopted for the equivalent frame model. Generally, even in the presence of an irregular opening distribution, the equivalent frame models are in a good agreement with the apply element method-based models. In terms of damage pattern, but also in terms of initial lateral stiffness and maximum base shear. This is because it's still possible to identify rigid regions and deformable portions, suggesting that the equivalent frame approach can be applied even in the presence of irregularities. The greater differences have been found when the irregularity consists of a small opening at ground level. The equivalent frame models obtained with the average effective height criterion in yellow and the limited effective height criterion in gray have initial lateral stiffness and base shear that increase with reducing the regular opening at the ground level, so from configuration 1 to configuration 5 in this picture. Consistently with what was obtained with the apply element method-based model in blue. In this picture. On the contrary, the use of the minimum effective height criterion lead to greater initial lateral stiffness and maximum base shear in configuration 8, even compared to configuration 5. Where one opening is missing and thus should represent a higher limit for both initial lateral stiffness and maximum base shear. Actually, the results obtained with the apply element method for the configuration with a small opening, so for configuration 8, And without that opening, so for configuration 5 are very close, and this suggests that the small window, when the window is very small, it can be neglected. Looking at the damage pattern in the apply element method base model, it is still possible to identify undeformable portion and parts affected by damage to be idealized in the equivalent frame model. There is also a good agreement in terms of failure mechanism with shear failure predicted by the equivalent frame model when the apply element method base model shows diagonal cracks. In some cases, as in configuration 8, the criterion of the minimum effective heights leads to greater rigid nodes comparing to the other two criteria, but also comparing to what was predicted by the apply element method base model. These greater rigid nodes leads to higher stiffness and lateral strength. Moreover, the two models predicted significantly different responses, with the IM that predicted the apply element method based model predicted the lateral response mainly governed by the diagonal shear failure, whereas the equivalent frame model predicted a global cantilever behavior of the whole facade. Analyzing the stress distribution, we noted that the presence of the small opening in configuration 8 did not affect the stress distribution, which is the same presented by configuration 5 in both directions. In configuration 7, so in the presence of a greater opening, the distribution of stress was affected by the presence of this opening and also the crack propagation. So, analyzing the evolution of stress and cracks, we say that the first two configurations have the same behavior, and thus the small opening of configuration 8 can be neglected, as its presence do not affect the stress distribution and the global behavior. Concluding, we can say that even in the presence of an irregular opening distribution, it's still possible to identify recurring uncracked region and portions of the structure where damage is concentrated, suggesting that it's still possible to idealize the structure into an equivalent frame model. Generally, we can say that small openings may be neglected when their presence do not affect the stress distribution, and considering the development of compression struts may help to define a more accurate geometry, for instance, suggesting to neglect the small openings. Generally, the average effective height criterion, so the one implemented in the software Tremori, and the limited effective height criterion resulted in prediction of lateral response more consistent with those obtained with advanced micromodels. But the minimum effective height criterion should be applied when the presence of strong lintels or existing cracks suggests the development of reduced piers. I concluded this webinar, so thank you for your attention and see you at the next webinar.